All right, so this video we're going to review intermolecular forces and some of the applications that go along with the IMFs. All right, so the first one we're going to talk about is London dispersion forces. So London dispersion forces happen between nonpolar molecules, and basically it's when nonpolar molecules attract each other because they have small coulombic or electrostatic forces of attraction. This is one of those things that you might read it in a multiple choice question, or you might have to say it in an FRQ. So basically, if you have a nonpolar molecule, electrons are present in those molecules. Well, electrons can sometimes move around in the molecule and then create a temporary dipole. So on this side, we've got all of our electrons, and that creates a negative end and a positive end. And what will happen is it will attract other molecules with the same temporary dipole. So these forces that hold the molecules together, they're called electrostatic forces of attraction because it's negative and positive ends attracting each other. All right, so it's caused by the movement of electrons, so we're going to create these temporary dipoles, but because they're temporary, the electrons can move again and then the dipole can disappear, so it's not very strong. So it's the weakest IMF, and then this is the prominent intermolecular force in nonpolar molecules. So when we have nonpolar molecules that stick together, it's because of that LDF. Now, technically, all molecules can experience some London dispersion forces because they have electrons that can move too. So if there's more electrons present, then you have more chances to create these temporary dipoles. So they have greater intermolecular forces. This is usually seen with a higher mass. So if we're comparing molecules and they're nonpolar, we can look at the mass, and the more massive molecules will have a stronger LDF. And we wouldn't say that it's because the mass is bigger, though. We would say that there are more polarizable electrons. So you might see this phrase in a multiple choice, but also if you're talking about it in an FRQ, don't say it's because the mass is bigger. Say it's because they have more polarizable electrons, so electrons that can move and make these dipoles. This is present in all molecules, so even polar molecules exhibit some LDF. And this can also be enhanced if you have pi bonds. So if you have a double or triple bond, you have these pi bonds, which means that we have more chances for LDF to happen. All right, so when we look at dipole-dipole, dipole-dipole would be between polar molecules. So it's the Coulombic attractions between polar molecules. And the difference is these polar molecules have a partial positive and a partial negative end, and that is not a temporary thing. It's a permanent dipole. So again, the positive end attracts the negative end of another molecule. And this is going to be something that's important in particle diagrams. So if you have to draw a particle diagram, you need to make sure the positive is sticking with the negative end of the other molecule, because that's what's going to happen. That's what's going to be attracting each other. All right, so it has a medium strength, so it's stronger than LDF. But if we're comparing a polar to a nonpolar, sometimes nonpolar molecules can actually have stronger IMFs because they're larger, meaning they have more polarizable electrons. Sometimes that overtakes the fact that we've got this permanent dipole. All right, so here's an example of that. So explain why Cl2, the boiling point of Cl2 is higher than HCl's. Well, let's look at what we have here. Cl2 is this, and HCl is this. Well, this we know is nonpolar. There's no difference in electronegativity, so there's no reason there should be a dipole. And we know that chlorine is very electronegative. It's very close to fluorine, and hydrogen is not that electronegative, so this will be polar. So our main IMF here should be dipole-dipole. and this one should be LDF. However, what you actually end up seeing is that Cl2 has a higher boiling point than HCl. So even though HCl has dipole-dipole forces, and it should have a stronger intermolecular force, which means it should take more energy to boil it, it doesn't. And that's because of the mass, or rather, the amount of polarizable electrons. So Cl2 has mass of about 70. And this one has a mass of about 36, or maybe 37. So when I look at it, this one is twice the mass of this one. It has more electrons that can polarize, that can create that temporary dipole, which makes the LDF stronger in this case. Now, if they're similar size, so if you're comparing two molecules that are of similar size, the polar one will definitely have a stronger intermolecular force and therefore a higher boiling point. All right, so when we look at hydrogen bonds, it's a special type of dipole-dipole, but it's when a hydrogen is bonded directly to an O, N, or F. And that's because of the size of hydrogen and the fact that it's one proton, one electron. So if it is bonded directly to something highly electronegative, like these three atoms, then it's going to create a very strong dipole. So it is the strongest intermolecular force when we compare the three. And basically, when we have hydrogen bonding, you need to make sure that you are looking, that you're looking at where the hydrogen bonds should be. So when we look at water, oxygen is more electronegative, so that means that it's going to have a negative end on the oxygen and positive ends by the hydrogen. So the positive ends attract the negative ends. So the hydrogen bond has to be between the hydrogen that's bonded directly to an oxygen here and an oxygen bonded directly to a hydrogen. So you need to make sure that what you're looking at is actually H bonding. So for example, if I had this molecule, and I happen to have water molecule in there too. Well, this would technically not be a hydrogen bond because it's not an O bonded directly to an H. So the hydrogen bond has to happen between a H bonded directly to an O, N, or F, and that hydrogen bond itself lies in between two molecules that have that. So you need to be careful about when you're looking at your particle diagrams. Oh, okay, so here's another example. So if we have a particle diagram, and this one is something that we typically see now, it's with an ionic compound being dissolved. So the positive end of the sodium will be very attracted to the oxygen end of the water. So you need to be careful that you are looking at the positive with the negative. Now, this isn't a hydrogen bond. A hydrogen bond would only occur right here. So the oxygen with the hydrogen of the other water molecule. All right, so when we talk about these intermolecular forces, we need to really be able to use that to apply in different situations like boiling point and vapor pressure. So those intermolecular forces contribute to the properties of those molecules. So if we have a strong intermolecular force, it's going to lead to a higher boiling point and melting point because it's going to take more energy to pull those molecules apart. Stronger IMFs will also lead to a lower vapor pressure. And when we're talking about vapor pressure, basically anytime you have a container of a liquid, and it could be, well, it will be in an enclosed container. Basically, molecules inside that liquid will actually start to escape into the space of the container. Well, if it has a strong intermolecular force, that means that the molecules are going to stick together and basically stay in the liquid portion of the container. So we're not going to have as many molecules in this space. Now, if you have a lower strength intermolecular force, you're going to have more molecules that escape the liquid portion, go into the gas, and then there's going to be more molecules hitting the walls of the container, so there's going to be more pressure. And remember, your London dispersion forces will increase with more electrons. Now, some other things that you might see would be surface tension and capillary action. So surface tension is the amount of force that holds a ball of a substance together. So basically, anytime you see little beads of water after it rains, those are all the molecules kind of like adhering and sticking to each other, and that's because they have strong intermolecular forces. So the higher the intermolecular force, the higher the surface tension. So if you have something like oil, oil is not going to bead as much as water because the molecules aren't as attracted to each other. So you can also see this exhibited when we look at a capillary tube. So in a capillary tube, that's a small, thin tube, and basically liquid can actually move up a very thin tube, and it's like basically fighting gravity, moving up, and that happens with cohesion and adhesion. Cohesion is when the molecules inside the liquid are attracted to each other, and then adhesion is when they adhere to a surface. So basically, as it's moving up this little tube, some water molecules are adhering to the surface of the walls of the container, and then the other molecules that are attracted to those molecules are sticking with those molecules that are moving up the walls of the container. And this is usually seen best with polar substances or with stronger intermolecular forces. All right, so if we're trying to mix liquids, we will need to make sure that they have similar IMFs. So like dissolves like. So dipole with dipole, hydrogen bonding with hydrogen bonding, even though technically, water will dissolve something that's not necessarily hydrogen bonding. So basically, like dissolves like. If it's polar, it dissolves with the polar substance. Nonpolar substances will not dissolve into polar, just like water and oil. Oil is a nonpolar substance, and water is a polar. So basically, one will sit on top of the other. Another application that we're going to see would be biological applications. So they might insert some of this information into a prompt or into a question somewhere. So when we look at enzymes, enzymes will combine with their substrate. So remember, an enzyme will bind to something called a substrate, and usually it's called the lock and key model. That's not always the case though. And usually what happens is they come together because they have similar IMFs at that spot that the substrate binds at. Also, the structure of proteins is created through intermolecular forces. So basically, as you have a primary structure, so you have a chain of amino acids, what'll happen is they'll start to bend and actually make these intermolecular forces with the other amino acids and start to fold. Now, once we get to our main structure, you might also see that the protein itself has places where it's polar and then nonpolar, and then that contributes to the function of the protein. And then you can also see hydrogen bonding happening in DNA. That's the reason we have a double helix. The molecules will start to bind with each other, and then it twists into this double helix. So in between our bases, we have these hydrogen bonds, and that's what creates that double helix shape.